please welcome Aron.
My name is Aron Parker, and I'm a substitute teacher. Recently, a student came up to me and asked me a question that any respectable teacher would dread hearing. Mr. Parker, do I have an erection? Upon hearing the words, my life instantly flashed before my eyes, which I had, of course, closed, as any respectable person would upon hearing the word erection. And then my mind was flooded by existential thoughts. Who am I? Why am I here? And what terrible series of events must have occurred to be in this dreaded place? Well, my search for self-identity goes back many years. When I was in fifth grade, my teacher asked everyone in the class what they wanted to be when they grew up. Most of the kids picked practical things, you know, like a cop, a firefighter, a doctor, or a subprime mortgage broker, that kind of thing. But me, I chose a Jedi. Unfortunately, you can't choose to be a Jedi. That's the kind of career that can only be forced on you. Good night, everybody. Sometimes I think maybe I've been too influenced by the media. When I was a kid, I played so much Pac-Man that I developed an eating disorder. And I watched so much TV that I was always, and I still am, constantly singing commercial jingles to myself. You know, ksh, brush your breath with Dentine. Ksh, I'm a pepper, he's a pepper, she's a pepper, we're a pepper. Wouldn't you like to be a pepper too? Be a pepper, dream Dr. Pepper. Ksh. Well, that's mighty good to me, cause Tootsie Rolls are all I need. We wear short shorts. Short shorts. At least those were catchy, but then I found myself reciting the most boring of commercials, too. Last week I had quite a scare. I had to take Beth to the hospital. They had me filling out forms up here. Sign this, sign that, sign here, sign there. It's tough when you're worrying all along. I knew Medicare wouldn't cover everything. Well, Beth came home. We decided to look into healthcare plans. She says, I'm picky. She's right, I am picky. I'm not plan called Secure Horizons. No premiums, no deductibles. Not bad, huh? Why are these things in my head? I'll say to myself. And do these things, the being in my brain, define me as a person? My brain will often answer with a random nonsensical answer such as, am I a stinker? Or, you're despicable. Or, hey, monkey, which people are rubbing in the head? Or, or more simply, ha ha! Oh, it's hard to know what events shape our neuroses. When I was a kid, my parents' house was teepeed once. We had these giant pine and cedar trees in the yard, and the toilet paper clung to the needles like tinsel on a Christmas tree. It took forever to get it all down, and just as I was about to start throwing some of it away, my grandmother stopped me.
No, Aron, you can't throw that away. Do not waste the paper. It is perfectly good paper. We have to use it.
And so, dutifully, we rolled up roll after roll of toilet paper and put it in our bathrooms. And for months afterwards, we had to be careful every time we went to the toilet because we had to check for pine needles to pick them out of the toilet paper. And oh God, the sap. I found that I think I have become, over the years, a bathroom person. I do all my best thinking in the bathroom, I believe. I'm so comfortable in there. I always thought that if I ever became a scientist, I would have my workplace be in the bathroom. It would be worth it just so I could say to people, hello, and welcome to my laboratory. And yes, I would, of course, be an evil vampire scientist. I found over the years that a lot of my self-image, at least, can be caught up in the hair. I used to have such wonderful, rich, luxuriant hair. It was the kind of hair that birds could nest in. When I started balding, I went through the 5 stages of hair loss grief, which of course are denial, anger, bargaining, comb over, and the nuclear option. I think it looks sort of cool, but whenever I put a baseball cap on, my wife tells me that I look like an 8-year-old with leukemia. Before I cut it all off, though, I tried that hair powder stuff that you put on. You're supposed to sprinkle it on so that it fills in the spaces and makes your hair look richer and fuller, and it did work in that respect. However, I didn't know it came off quite so easily. I used it during a job interview. During that job interview, you know, I kind of put my fingers in my hair. This led to what I think is probably the most awkward parting handshake in job interview history. Scratching an itch under my nose during that same interview turned out to be a mistake, too, because I was pretty sure I hadn't started the day with a Hitler mustache. So, anyway, I've also found over the years that I think diseases can say a lot about a person, but I'm not going to talk about that part right now because that's the wrong page of my script. I'm going to talk about how faith affects us, because I think a lot of people find a great sense of themselves through their faith. Me, though, I've never been a religious person, so I haven't been able to do that. I once, when I was younger, a little bit younger, I believed in Santa Claus for a long time, and it was terrible when I found out that it wasn't real, because I still can feel inside of me deep the embarrassment that I had sobbing right there in front of my wife. It was very hard. The concept of an afterlife I find extremely terrifying. Just imagining your loved ones watching you all the time, watching over you, looking at you everywhere, doing everything, even when you're in the bathroom doing your stuff. I mean, it terrifies me to think of my grandmother watching me when I'm sitting on the toilet, her ghost accusing me of wasting toilet paper. Oh my gosh. My grandmother, she's always kind of with me, but especially in the bathroom, it's just too awkward. And so, I hate to admit this, at one point, I became so paranoid about this that I started bringing an umbrella with me into the bathroom. And I would open it just so nobody upstairs could imagine while I was doing my stuff. But you don't know how incredibly difficult it is to do your business while you're holding an umbrella in one hand and the toilet paper in the other. For starters, it's almost impossible to pull the pine needles out of the toilet. Oh, my grandmother. I don't know how many of my worries came from her. I think probably I became a worrisome person from her worries, because my grandmother loved to worry. She was also a very fatalistic person, too. I remember once she was telling me how to use the furnace in her house, and she was explaining it to me like this.
Aron, you have to be careful when you do this, but you have to listen closely because you may need to know this after I die. This will probably be very soon. All right, when you turn it on, make sure you turn it this way and not this way, or the house will burn down. Also, make sure you lift this up like this and do not let it touch to here, or the house will burn down. Also, be careful, because even if you do all of this, the house may still burn down. Probably it may be safer if you not use the furnace and put on a sweater instead.
My grandmother, she had to be downbeat about everything. This little, she was only 5 feet tall, but she refused to acknowledge even that milestone achievement, insisting she was only 4'12". And you got that one. Most people have to think about that. She also liked to instill in us a healthy dose of guilt all the time. This was a woman who escaped from Nazi Germany. Okay. But then you don't answer the phone immediately, and it's like the end of the world to her. She used to leave the saddest messages on our family's answering machine.
Hello? Hello? Why are you not picking up the phone? I know that you are at home. Hello? I guess you do not want to talk to me. Your dear mother
Well, I'm pretty sure I've inherited my grandmother's tendency to worry about things, because I'm worrying constantly about this and that and everything. For instance, I worry about what would happen if I were going to the bathroom during an earthquake. What if I'm sitting there and the quake happens at that perfect moment where you'll die if you don't get up, but you'll die if you do? I mean, do you evacuate? And there's really no graceful way to exit to safety in that kind of situation, you know, with your hands half down, holding the umbrella. Sometimes, you know, a disease can say a lot about who a person is, especially how we face that disease. My disease stems from a sports injury to my knee when I was 12 years old. And by sports injury, I mean that I was tossing grapes in the air and trying to catch them in my mouth. And I dove for one and went down. It was dramatic. I could barely get up, and then I couldn't walk for a week due to tremendous tenderness and possible tearing between my patellar tendon and my tibial tuberosity. Yeah, I said it right. That's my favorite line of the whole thing. Oh, the tremendous tenderness and possible tearing between my patellar tendon and my tibial tuberosity. I'm just going to say it over and over again. No, I'll go into the next line. What was more important was that my doctor told me what this condition was called. Even though it didn't involve germs or degeneration, this was called Osgood's Schlatter's disease. And I just thought that was the coolest thing ever. First of all, it had disease in it, so I could tell people about that. And the Schlatter's sounded just German enough to scare kids, so I could go out on the playground and I could tell people, hey, get out of my way. I got Osgood Schlatter's disease. Oh well, I grew up, and sometimes now today it saddens me that so few people have heard of Osgood Schlatter's my disease. And even though most of the symptoms of this disease went away after a few years, I still try to tell every single person I meet that I have it. Hi, my name is Aron Parker, and I have Osgood Schlatter's disease. And this probably explains why I didn't go out on a date till my 30s. That's true. Let's not go into that right now. But then I found this one special lady. I went up to her and I said, hello, my name is Aron Parker, and I have Osgood Schlatter's disease. Hello, Aron, she said. My name is Alice, and I have seborrheic dermatitis. Oh, it was love at first sight. Or at least that's what it seemed at first. In the end, it didn't work out between us. Turned out I made a rash decision. My only regret is she wasn't named Emma, because then she would have been my ex, Emma. I think a lot of diseases have the wrong name. They just don't sound like what they're supposed to be. Polio, for instance. Am I the only one who ever thought polio was just a sport you played on horseback? And herpes. Herpes just sounds way too friendly to be a disease. Herpes, 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 herpes. I just sound so happy to say it. Herpes! Years ago, I named my dog Herpes. He was part of a litter, and I gave them all fun names, but I couldn't keep them all. So I gave chlamydia to a friend, and I gave polio to a lady down the street. Oh, but herpes, I could never get rid of herpes if I tried. Oh, but, and this may surprise some of you, I actually wanted to be a doctor at one point in my life because I thought I should be a doctor like my grandfather. And so I enrolled in college as a pre-med student. Unfortunately, I quickly realized that I was scared of hospitals, grossed out by blood, repulsed by sick people, and was a hypochondriac who was afraid of germs. So I became a school teacher instead. And as I said before, I am now working as a substitute teacher, which is so much fun. I get to be some people say that you are your career. I don't know if that's true or not, but if a substitute teacher is who I am, does that mean that I'm a different person every day? I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing if it's true. What I have found is that I deal with a lot of the same issues every day, and I discover a lot of things about people. For instance, I found that to high schoolers, nearly every word you can think of means to them masturbation. I said to some students the word exaggerate.
He said exaggerate? Oh my God.
Exacerbate.
Exacerbate.
And then there's that magical word, masticate. Masticate. I tell the kids that everybody masticates, and there's nothing wrong whatsoever with mastication at all. In fact, I masticate all the time, several times a day, in fact. My mother has walked in on me on multiple occasions and caught me masticating. Sometimes we masticate together. And then there was the high school student who brought to me the question of doom. Mr. Parker, do I have an erection? And as I said, my leg flashed before my eyes, and when I opened them, he thrust in front of me a large, red, swollen, festering finger. He had a cut on it. It was an infection. I think when our nation's students don't know, or they think that everything means masturbation, but they don't even know what an erection is, I believe that our schools have failed. But that's when I decided, just for a moment, that I would stop worrying about who I was, and I would just be who I was, whatever that may be. And so I turned to that student, and I immediately sang him a chipmunk song, taught him about Secure Horizons healthcare plans, lectured him about toilet paper conservation, showed him pictures of my cute little herpes, and taught him all about Osgood Schlatter's disease. Then I gave him a Band-Aid and told him if he ever had another erection, I didn't want to see it. Thank you.